Welcome to the Everything Actioncast, the official podcast of everythingaction.com.
Hello and welcome to the Everything Actioncast, the podcast for the week of April 29th, 2024. I'm your host, Zach.
I'm your host, co-host Chris.
And yeah, this week we are jumping off buildings, getting set on fire, and all sorts of other stunts-related activities, because we are watching, or we watched the original The Fall Guy. We watched the first episode, which is basically like a movie. It's like a 90-minute special. Because the new Fall Guy is out right now, if you're hearing this, the Ryan Gosling and Emily Blunt reboot of The Fall Guy. But yeah, the original one with Lee Majors, which was a pretty big hit back in the 80s. If you look at like Nielsen ratings, it was it had like a 19 for like the first three seasons, which was pretty, like, that's especially in like the 80s, that was like a really solid Nielsen rating, and it was like ranked in like the top 20 or top 30 of all TV shows at the time. And I think definitely remember Fall Guy. I think it's like a, you know, it's a cult favorite. It's like a, people remember it like along with like the A Team and stuff like that. Although maybe like it's not. I don't think it's quite like that, like, you know, Miami Vice, Magna PI, A Team like level of popularity, but it's probably like the next slot down.
I think that was just because of the late marketing when they syndicated this. This was always on the back burner. And Magnum PI and A Team was just everywhere. I think like at least A Team had like a toy line. Magnum PI didn't.
Well, Fall Guy had like some toys. Not a lot, but had some. And there was like a video game, but I think it was like for like British computer systems, like this like ZX Spectrum and stuff like that. And then there was like a board game. So there, and I think like his, like, you know, the truck, like they made one of the, like the Ertl or something, one of the like model toy or model truck companies made like a Fall Guy truck.
Is truck that famous?
That's like, I mean, that's one of the most famous parts of the show is like his, like, you know, his pickup truck they drive, because they use it like every episode basically to like do something. But yeah, the basic premise of the show is that Lee Majors is Colt Seaver, and he is a Hollywood stuntman. But because of how sporadic the Hollywood stunt jobs are, apparently he has to moonlight as a bounty hunter, and he goes around and then captures people who skip bail. Which, and I love that he keeps the law that like gives him legally lets him do that, like, in his like glove box.
I guess to explain how bounty hunting works.
Yeah.
Yeah, you needed to do that. I also would get that shit laminated. I wouldn't just trust
like the like the guy from Transformers with like the Romeo and Juliet laws.
So creepy.
Yeah,
it's laminated, but not the bounty hunter like permit.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not even a permit. It's like a California, he just has the California law printed out, like, you can legally go after people who skip bail.
I feel like you have to be certified to do that. You just can't do
apparently
that.
Not.
Wow, I wonder if that California law still exists.
is that my dog, the bounty hunter, can just go to do whatever he wanted?
Well, he's in Hawaii.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I don't know if it's like a national law or like a state law.
I don't think that's a national law. You just can't.
You can't just go around bounty hunting people.
Yeah, you can't. I think there's an actual like thing to prevent you from just being a hunt. Like, I know people joke about being bounty hunters because that's like half of those bounty hunter movies where they fall into bounty hunting. And the Fall Guy seems like he is legit. He's been doing this for years. There's like a whole, even before the first episode, it's alluded to that he's been doing this for quite a while.
Oh yeah, yeah. He's got a whole system. He's got this like relationship built up with Big Jack, Samantha Jackson, like the bail bondsman, who is like the most like unassuming bail bondsman. She's like a very like proper like housewife looking. I think they imply she inherited it from her father, and then she's just like kind of fell into it being a bail bondsman.
The part I don't understand about her role is that she kind of like shows up and is like, yep, I'll bail you out. Like, I'll be your bail person. And then she's always the one that turns around that goes, okay, no, I need to send the bounty hunter after you.
Well, yeah, because she's giving all these, she's giving these people money, and then like Colt is like, oh, you always like give everyone all these sob stories money, and that's why I don't.
Oh,
like she's way more sympathetic than she should be for being a bail bondsman, but then
yeah, that's like the downfall to her character, and she's not actually a good bails person because essentially they're gonna run the bail that she put up is actually gonna increase. I think like if you skip out on your bail thing, I think automatically they like jack up the rate.
Well, Big Jack has to. She had to pay it. She had to pay their bail. So that's like, because they're supposed to pay her back when. That's how that whole thing works. Like, she pays their bail, and then they're supposed to pay. Then they get out of jail, and then they're supposed to pay her back.
So I think also but she's like, think about it. I think then the bailsman is like her enforcer. Like, Colt is just basically her enforcer.
Yeah.
This is a weird system. The more you think about the Fall Guy, the weird. Like, they did this for 5 seasons.
On top of being a stuntman.
Yeah. And they really started early saying, like, they really identify that, like, Lee Majors doesn't look like a young guy anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And, it shows you that, like, there's a change in times with the first episode. Even though this is the first episode, you're like, am I missing something? Because it just, if you didn't get what was going on in the 3 intros,
yes,
like the voiceover, the second voiceover, and then a music number.
Yeah, there's like a whole intro from like Lee Majors being like it's like an ode to the stuntman. And then there's like a instrumental kind of like title sequence, or like some of the titles come up, and then there's like it cuts like a stunt, and after the stunt, then it's like then we get the full Fall Guy theme song, which is sung by Lee Majors. It's Unknown Stuntman, which apparently became like a radio hit, or they got released as a single. And I guess I think Blake Shelton is singing a version of that for the movie this time. Which I'm a little disappointed it's not Ryan Gosling singing it to keep the start, you know, the start of the thing singing the theme song alive, but
yeah, that's weird. You know, it's been proven that he can sing the I'm Just Ken.
Yeah, keep that energy going.
I feel like this was filmed right after or during the same time as Barbie.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, his voice didn't change. It wasn't like 10 years after. Now they're trying to do a Fall Guy. It's literally the same year they filmed Barbie that they could have done a new single for him. But let's go back to the crazy world of 80s, well, technically late 70s, early 80s Hollywood, where basically calling a stunt is sort of like ordering a pizza. It just seems like when they need like one specific stunt shot, then they call the Fall Guy. Then if he's not there, then it's like, all right, well, here's your $5, get out.
Yeah, it's really like it makes it seem like a very like mercenary business instead of just like having like a stunt team that like for the whole movie. It's like, oh, we set someone on fire today. Call Colt Seavers. He'll come in for one day and do the stunt and then leave.
He doesn't need to know the context. He doesn't need to know, like, you know, any kind of like plot. You know, like, he just go do the stunt. Cool. Bye. I already mm-hmm. catch this bounty hunter like that's been I've been chasing for like 3 months.
Yeah, because yeah. I was saying he's not like sitting on the set like I guess he is sitting in the set for like on that he's on the James Coburn racing movie whatever that movie is. But it seems like he's just there for that like car crash / burn sequence. Then he's just like, well, let's go, cousin. Like we gotta call about this bounty. Let's go. No, I think it's his cousin.
Is it?
Yeah. But he's like much, 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 much younger cousin. Who is a dipshit.
Oh, yeah. He's like so sleazy, and then like just his introduction's weird, because he's sort of like a Jimmy Olsen character.
Mm-hmm.
but then you find out he's just like a pervert.
And there's like the whole running joke where he just keeps saying like, "Oh, I spent like 6 months at studying law at Harvard. I spent 2 months pre med at like." He's, he keeps saying like he's like going to all these different colleges for like, but like only for like a small amount of time.
I think that stops later on.
It stopped in like the episode. Like it was like the first, because this first episode is basically two episodes, and they combined them into the one like 90-minute one. But you can feel like it, because it's 42 minutes, like the whole like story shifts to like the second story, and then in the second half they basically get rid of that whole like running joke thing of like him saying that he like studied or like did something for like a small amount of time, but that makes him an expert in it. Like when the kid gets run down on the bike.
Yeah, that happens so jarringly from like how fun and jovial the beginning is, where it's like Hollywood and stunt acting and lighthearted bounty hunting, and then when it's just an old guy runs over a kid and it's shot very TV movie like, because mm-hmm. it's like very quick cut, bicycle in the air. However, the horrible thing is the it's just like how slow of a progression is. Like, oh, he's fine. Yeah, you're good. Oh, he's dead. You know, like
yeah, it's like a doctor shows up is on the scene. Like Lee Majors calls like an ambulance and they're like, you're gonna be all right, kid. And
it,
then
it's very downplayed of how it seriously injured it is. That's the problem. Where like then it's like, oh, he passed away. It's like, oh,
yeah, because you find out like the villain of the second half, Big John Kramer, who is the sheriff of this town in Arizona. Played by Eddie Albert, who I think was probably best known before this. He's been in a bunch of stuff, but like Green Acres.
He was the farmer?
Yes, he was Jurassic like, Board's like husband in Green Acres.
Wow. I thought the guy, like, he that like that's another thing on this movie. Or not, sorry, not the movie, but this show. Is that you'll recognize Hollywood actors. And I don't know half the time, are they just Hollywood actors, like playing themselves? Or are they someone like famous, fake famous, or just like regular people?
Yeah, because there'll be actors who are playing themselves on like whatever movie like Colt's working on. So like in this first episode, it's James Coburn and Farrah Fawcett. And then after that, there'll be other people who are playing themselves, but also other people are playing like not like they're playing a character.
Right. So it's a little meta. I needed some context for that. So I didn't know that I figured the villain in the second act is someone famous. I didn't think it was going to be the Green Acres guy. I think
yeah.
It'd be more hilarious if he was the Green Acres actor. Like, if it was himself and he just was.
he's like, do you mind a kid?
Yeah. Just like living off that Green Acres royalties and drunk driving around at Hollywood.
But that was that's such a crazy reveal where like Big Jack, she's like she calls him, he's like, hey, your bail went up because the kid died, so I'm gonna need a little bit more money.
And he's just like,
all right. He's like, sure, let me wire it. And then he's just like scram, he's like flees Hollywood. Why was he even in Hollywood to begin with? I want to know, because he's like a boss hog in Arizona, and then he like was in Hollywood for reasons.
Just to hang out,
but then he doesn't understand anything like how it works, because Colt is able to like completely just trick him into like thinking that a movie's gonna come to his town.
Maybe because he's just been living the good life for the last 10 years. It's implied that the sheriff sold out the town and made it like some horrible place to live that a lot of people live in.
Yeah, it's like the waitress met like lays out his whole scheme, and it's like she said like a defense contract or something came through, and then like the sheriff was able to like dig up dirt and everyone, because like they were using the police department as like the base for the defense contract or something.
I kind of zoned out on that one, to be honest.
I think he was like he kind of looked at he got files on everyone in town or something, and used that to like buy up like land or like buy businesses or something.
Own all the, like, before we get into that, because that's just like the not even the B plot, you know, that's like the C plot and all the things.
Well, I really appreciated how they like weaved them both in, where it's like the first half of the episode is like Lou Rawls is on the run, but then like Eddie Albert, like John Kramer is like there, and then but then he like disappears, but then like he comes back in the second half, and then Lou Rawls disappears, but then he comes back. So it's like this, like they set up both stories, and then they kind of like weave them both in.
Yeah, if you were to watch this with commercials on, you would just think something like you just forget plot points. You know, it really is a little like I don't think pilot episodes these days do something like this where the one plot, like both these plots are great. For them to be in the same same pilot is crazy. Because there's so much going on.
A lot of the 80s shows, like their first episodes are like TV movies. It's like they have like a 90-minute like event.
They would stretch it out. This villain would appear in the beginning and then kind of escalate, you know? But no, he deals with a nightclub incident.
Mm-hmm.
He deals with them, like, trying to... Well, then he sees a hit and run.
that was just incident on the way to his, like the A-plot of the first part of the episode.
And then at some point, like, I mean, we were winding back to the beginning. They take a whole big part to mention how poor Lee Majors is. So, like, his like, shack in the woods.
Yep. He's got horses, so.
So that's not poor, but it really just shows how, like, I guess, like, naive Colt's cousin is.
Yeah.
Because his cousin's like, why don't you live in a mansion? It's Hollywood.
It's Los Angeles, baby. Everyone lives in the mansion.
Yeah. And
stuntman is like the most lucrative career in the world.
It's a growing industry.
I will say, I think she's like a much bigger part of like later episodes. But yeah, Heather Thomas does not have a lot to do in this episode. Especially if they're trying to like introduce like the main cast, because she's like, you know, obviously that trio is the main trio of the show. It's like Lee Majors and then Douglas Barr, who plays Howie, and then Heather Thomas, and then they're just like, oh, make him a sandwich, and then she has like one stunt. She doesn't do the stunt because it's too dangerous. Because Lee Majors proves it's dangerous by throwing a light at a director off a building,
and then they're all fired. If you remember, he does the light trick. They're like, oh, okay. And then she's like, well, we're fired because like they have to redo everything or rethink this whole shot.
I thought it changed director's mind because he's like, hey, buy him a drink in my trailer. Like, because he got proven wrong. So
he says it, but they never go back and do the stunt.
Because they were gonna replace Heather Thomas with that other stunt woman who's like, oh, it's my turn now. I'll do the stunt. I don't care about my own safety.
I mean, she would have been dead.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay, so maybe they got fired, like the other consultants.
Yeah.
See what I mean? Like, there is a story where... There's probably, like, competing stunt teams.
I was just like, why would you have two different stunt teams on a movie? They're, like fighting each other as rivals.
It's the 70s and
80s. It's almost like they're, like, bit, like, it's like, oh, you're gonna do that, you'll do that stunt for $200? I'll do it for $100.
I bet you...
I'll undercut you.
No, I think that actually happens. They just
there's
no contract. That's another thing about this show that it just the Wild West of Hollywood. That's what I'm saying. Like, you just got paid to do the stunt. If you didn't do the stunt, you didn't get paid, and then mm-hmm. That's it. So maybe it's to show that this is why we have contracts and lawyers, so we don't just fall out of windows and not get paid for it.
Well, I mean, we were looking before we started, like, but there, I mean, there was, like, the stuntman's, like, association, like, their union existed, before this.
Yeah, but I guess trying to explain that to people who have no, like, I guess back in the 80s, no one wanted to know how movies are made.
Yeah, it's
the realism.
It's cleaner for the show if, like, Colt is, like, you know, he just, like, shows up and does, like, one stunt and then, like, leaves, and it's just, like, and then that explains why he doesn't have, like, he needs more money from, like, bounty hunting, because it's so, like... It could be like a long drought between stunts, so...
He does mention it, and I guess that's the point, is that stunt work is actually not very glamorous. It's basically just like doing birthday party gigs.
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because at the end, you see that he just does a stunt, and he's not having fun doing it. He's just like, ugh. He's like Krusty the Clown. Like, oh, I shouldn't have like drank before I did this stunt. Oh, hey, Farrah.
Mm-hmm.
But we'll get into the ending part. That's a bittersweet moment. But yeah, him bounty hunting, I guess, is also not very lucrative either, because he doesn't do that full time.
Well, it seems like it depends on how dangerous the person is, or how difficult it might be. Because Big Jack pays him like $10,000 to go after John Kramer.
I mean, he should ask for more. There are other crazy, like, in following episodes, they're not as insane as trying to take on a corrupt sheriff.
Yeah, but then I don't know how much I can't remember how much he was getting paid to go after Lou Rawls. But it was way less, because he was friends with Lou Rawls. He performed that club, the Palomino, the country bar that he goes to.
Also, I think in order to pay his rent, okay, so this is the logic. I get the logic. He was supposed to get Lou. If
yep.
Lou turned himself in, then he got paid. Lou never turned himself in, so now, Colt never got paid. So
yep.
That's why the next job is worth more, because he has to, make up the money he potentially could have made. Plus, I guess on paper, it just, get this guy.
Well, I think, too, because basically, Big John owes, $100,000 for his bail, Big Jack is like, oh, I'll give you, 10% of that or whatever, I'll give you $10,000 of that.
Gotcha.
So I think Lou Rawls is, bail is way, way less, so he gets a less percentage. So if it's a crazy $500,000 bounty bail or something, then he Colt would get a way bigger cut of it.
Who was he trying to bounty hunt? Marilyn Manson?
Yeah.
Charles Manson, sorry. You know what I mean?
And he doesn't, and he carries a gun with blanks in it. He does Bronson punches. He's not a full on action cop. He uses his stunt powers to fight guys, and also con artists them too. Come up with these schemes to trick them.
So he is a stuntman, but I guess the point is that he's got more endurance than fighting skills, because he gets beat up a lot in this one.
Oh man, that one scene where it's the guys who are harassing Lou Rawls follow him Colt back to his house, and then they're beating him up, and then you don't see him getting beat up. It's just cut to the boss listening to classical music on the car radio, but you just hear him just getting pummeled.
Oh yeah, it's a very poignant scene, and it's almost very it's out of place of the rest of the episode. It's very mafia like.
Yeah.
And do we forget about the beginning where Colt pretends to be a relative to capture a dude who is already in a full body cast?
Oh my god, yes.
So, the tone.
That's your introduction to this character, basically, is he breaks into a hospital and starts beating a man in a full body sling. And then the nurse is like, stop it, stop it. I need to get orderly.
Yeah, they're like, I don't know. Honestly, that woman had all right to be.
Yeah, she was totally in the right. It's a maniac came in and started attacking her patients. But then it turned out he was obviously faking it, because he's a criminal, and then he got arrested. And then I love that. I love that Colt brings him back to the police station, still in his bandages and cast and everything, even though it seems to be all fake.
No, I don't think that was fake.
So he was he got injured, but then he was. Because he was walking on his cast and stuff, but yeah, it's just that's such a crazy. Just here's a severely injured man that was skip bail, arrest him.
Yeah, and
I beat him senseless in the hospital.
And they make a point where they say, "Oh, if you're a bounty hunter using this weird bylaw, yeah, you're in charge of being your own police."
Mm-hmm.
That happens. There's a scene where he captures Lou, and then there's an argument about the law with the cops about, okay, well, yeah, you can't get an escort, you can't go to jail, you have to be basically the deputy, the jailer.
I think they probably should, like, I think the cops probably should have done, like, brought him to, like, wherever, but they're, like, they're being lazy, and you're just like, well, he's your, like, or no, it was in his warrant he had for, like, it's like, oh, it says, like, doesn't say anything about, like, arrest, you just have to bring him to court, so it's not our job.
Gotcha.
So I think it's partly legal and partly, like, the cops are just being lazy.
If anything, they're just showing you how the cops in this first episode are just untrustworthy.
But also, like, they smashed, like, a fire hydrant, and there's, like, an automobile accident, and they're just like, hey, let's get out of here. Let's go get some donuts.
Was that the other sheriffs?
No, that was, like, because, like, Lou was trying to get away, and he crashes a, like, giant, like, Cadillac into, like, a fire hydrant.
Yeah.
And then they Colt captured him. But so there's, like, water spraying in the middle of the street, and the cops are just like, eh, it's not a problem.
The public works will figure that out.
Yeah. And then Lou Rawls is in trouble because there were guys that were selling drugs off of his tour bus. But then he didn't know about it, but then he found out about it, but then they're like, they like beat his manager up, and then he got blamed for beating his manager up.
All of this is spoken, and like, just, they don't show you this for any context.
It's
so confusing. I thought I missed something when I was watching this. A lot of this is, hey, you should have been there, but we're not going to go back. We're going to slightly hint to it, or say that's what's happened, and it's just like, that just seems like plot, like, filler. They're just, like, fixing plot points they just never got to.
And then the drug dealer guys are threatening Lou Rawls' family, and to, like, it's like, hey, if you don't let us keep selling drugs off your bus, we'll kill your wife and baby.
So, does he tour that often? Does he tour only in one town? Because how did they restock drugs then?
And are they just following him, or like are they on the bus? Be like, hey, we're new manager and security guys. Like, we're on the bus now.
So your drug dealers are also your band manager?
Yeah, I think. I mean, he said he was his manager, but I think he was just like lying to the Colt.
Gotcha. That makes sense then. I don't know. It just seems like a bad drug business of selling drugs out of the famous, like, musician's, like, tour bus.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But then he lives in L.A. or he lives in Hollywood. So where's he touring to?
Yeah. And for like a, it's like, he's a country Joe. So it's like they're probably going to, like, you know, country towns. So it's like, what are they're trying to sell, like, coke or something to, like, rednecks.
I guess some do meth and stuff, but here's the thing. Those country towns, southern things, they take drug enforcement, like, insanely strict.
Mm-hmm.
I think when we went to Texas, when we went to Austin, Zach, like, it was so, like, pro beer and alcohol. Like, it was just, like, I couldn't imagine trying to be like, hey, coke, like, get the fuck out.
Yeah. But it's also like their gang is like three guys. You never see any other members of that group. So it's just like this, like these three guys are just like this entire drug operation.
I mean, that's all you needed, I guess, because you have basically the guy in head just sitting in the car and then listening to music, and then you have the two muscle. But I guess for like, because it's such a subplot during this whole thing. They just wanted no effort. You don't even see drugs. You know, they keep mentioning drugs. You don't even see anything.
Yeah. Well, it's weird too, because that feels like, so like if you split it in two, that should be like they should have resolved all that in the first half of it, because that was the first episode technically. But they don't resolve anything. It's just like cuts to, like Lou Rawls and his family like drive away. They're like, we gotta get out of here, and then it cuts Colt's on his next job going after the sheriff. So it's just like, I was thinking like, oh, like did Lou Rawls just drive away and they're never gonna see him, never hear about him or see him again? It's like, It's like, well, he got away. But it does come back later on. But yeah, it's wild. You kind of forget he was in the episode. And it's like, and he shows back up later on. It's like, oh, right. That was happening. And they never resolved what was going on with that.
Yeah, it's just like, I forget, especially if I wasn't paying attention diligently to, like, everyone's dialogue. Yeah, it is just like, jump, jump, jump. Oh yeah, remember this? Like, oh, surprise.
Well, yeah, second half of the episode, they drive to, Colt and his cousin go to Arizona, whatever town it is. I can't remember if they mentioned the name of the town, but it's like some small town in Arizona that basically... the sheriff owns half of it, and everyone in town hates the sheriff because he, like, screwed them all over. And, like, Lee Majors and his cousin, like, don't they like constantly saying, like, oh, we're friends of him, and everyone's like, they get like thrown out, they get like bar fights and like stuff thrown at them, like beaten up, and it's like they still ask people, they're still like going with that ruse. It's like, I think after, like, the third person that, like showed, like, clearly that, like, they hate that person, like, I would, like, choose a different, like, strategy of trying to, like, figure out information.
Yeah. Like, the... So, there is, like, almost, like, a... I'm trying to think what I'm looking at. It's, like, Mel Brooks-esque part of the second act where they go to the town... And they mention trying to talk about, like, the sheriff. And everyone loses their goddamn mind.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, like, the guy's name is everywhere. And if someone out of town, which is most likely, and you're just like, hey, like, what's this? And it's like, wait, you don't know what this is? Like, no, I see the name. How dare you, outsider?
Your friends, they called you in from, like, he called you in from out of town, like, hassle us? Like, we'll kill you. Like...
Yeah, but then it's like, hassle them, like, they're the cops. Like, they already have that protection. It's not like, oh, he's a furniture, like, emperor guy. You know, like, he's just an evil businessman. But it's like, oh, shit, no, he's, like, the law enforcement. That's harder to skirt through.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, what if they are cops? Because they kind of mention, like, oh, like, we'll just say we're cops or something. And it's just like, oh, so you potentially... The people that are coming to the town and looking for Kramer are some sort of cop or mafia, but these people have no fear to fight them.
Yeah, like, it was they go to, like, a restaurant, and then, like, one guy's at the restaurant, and then, like, he starts a bar fight with them. It's like the entire bar is just beating each other up, but eventually, it's like Colt and his cousin are able to, like, crawl away, and then the guys are still fighting each other.
Okay, is it another plot that just couldn't fit in? Is with that whole military contract, they've been, like, dumping lead into the water, so that's causing everyone to act, like, insane.
Yeah, or, like, there's, like, the woman they try to, like, talk to on the street, and then, Howie saves her from, like, getting hit by a truck, and then she's like, "Hey, get off me! Like, you bastard! Like, get away from me!" And then it seems like the truck that almost hit her was, like, her, like, husband or boyfriend or something. She gets in it and just, like, drives away. And she's just, like, yelling at them still.
She knew that guy. I think that was just, like, another townie, and then,
yeah,
got into his truck. I think yeah. that's how I interpreted it. And I was like, what is going? Like, they rather trust people that, like,
almost ran them over.
Yeah, like. I think maybe, like, she may or may not have recognized in town, like, your neighborhood, you know? And mm-hmm. That's another thing. This episode, a lot of people trying to get hit by cars.
People either almost getting hit by cars or definitely getting hit by cars, like the kid on the bike.
Kid on the bike, right? The woman in the street.
Yep.
Guy jumping out of a helicopter.
Yep.
A lot of car incidences. And then... car chases, like, I do admit, for the first episode, they pack in a lot of action sequences and stunts, real stunts.
Well, that's a classic, like, you know, they don't really do that anymore, because, like, the first episodes back in the 80s and 90s were, like, you got, like, a whole bunch of money, you shot the pilot, and then the pilot was, like, basically determined how you got, if you got a show or not, because you basically showed, like, network, like, here's the pilot, and then it's, like, and then they're, like, oh, yeah, we'll pick you up for however many episodes, but now it's like, oh, it's greenlit for an entire first season. We don't really care about you don't have to really care about the pilot anymore to, like, make an impression. But yeah, back, but you know, back in like 80s and 90s, like the pilot was like everything. Like that was like you pour a ton of money into it, and then you had to like basically show off like everything the show was possibly could do.
I did like in this pilot, they didn't really try to set up a love story yet, but they hint at so many potentials.
But yeah, definitely like especially like the last I don't know half an hour of the episode is just like a gigantic like stunt car chase sequence.
Yeah, I think that's because it's focused, because it's easy to just comprehend. There's no like a lot of off-screen events didn't take place. You see a car chase, which is, you know, awesome. Awesome to see almost a Blues Brothers style stunt.
Yeah, it's very, very old school, very, you know, like, obviously they're obviously smashing cars. they do some classic, like Colt does, like, the classic, like goes off, like, a ramp and, like, gets his car on two wheels and drives that, like, that way for, like, a little bit. And then, like the guy behind him is like, "That looks easy." Then it immediately crashes, and then there's like a Dukes of Hazzard style jump over like a bridge that was out.
I do like how none of those cops, they're all dimwitted because of maybe the lead poisoning.
That yeah,
they don't figure out how they're paying for all these damages, or like, hey, this stunt's gotten way too dangerous. I thought this would be like a friendly audition.
Yeah. So basically, death race. Yeah, because Colt's scheme to like capture the sheriff is that he tells them they're in town because they're gonna shoot a Hollywood, like he's scouting for like a Hollywood movie, and then they want to shoot a scene where they're gonna do like a car chase to the town or to the county, but he wants to like make sure that like, and they want to use like all the like deputies to do it, but he wants to see like their driving skills ahead of time. So then the sheriff's like, "Oh yeah, sure," and then Colt's also like, "Can you get a helicopter here?" He's like, "Yeah, sure," and then. Yeah, and the cult leads them on this like crazy like chase through the desert, and like is like wrecking all their cars. And but then like because it's like for Hollywood, they don't care apparently, and they're like, "Oh yeah, oh man, I failed my Hollywood audition, but that's fine. They'll pay for it." Because yeah, it's like, I mean, at least like what, five or six of the cars gets like totally demolished.
Oh yeah.
Which most of the police cars in like this like small town are like destroyed now.
And there's a lot of police cars, I thought, for that small town.
It's yeah,
at least 10 cars. Mm-hmm. Maybe not all 10 get destroyed completely, but enough that it's gonna devastate that already messed up town. You know what I mean? Like that's gonna come out of taxpayers in that area, and they're already like a short fuse.
Yeah. He's doing all sorts of tricks. He's making dust clouds so they can't see, and he's like going off road. He's like doing all these like stuff to like lose them and smash them and dodge them. And then, but then his whole end game was he wanted to get the helicopter to land, and then he takes over the helicopter with his gun at gunpoint, and then like he can fly a helicopter, so he flies the helicopter with the sheriff in it. It's like, well, we're flying to like meet my cousin, we're driving back to like Los Angeles now. But then both the plots intersect because the drug dealer guys that were harassing Lou Rawls show up because they heard it on the radio. They went to the police station to like, try to find like Lou Rawls, and then they overhear like, oh, Colt Seavers at like this like whatever street or crossing or whatever. So they go after him.
Yeah, they know exactly where to go.
Yeah,
which is kind of funny because if someone just gave me a random like cross street, I would not know. You know, they're not from Arizona.
Yeah, it's like the middle of the desert. It's like just like it's like wherever road, and then but it's like Lee Majors like went off road for like miles. So it's just like, where are they? He's also now in a helicopter too. It's just like, I guess it's the only helicopter like within like miles of where they are. So it's just you can find it, but yeah.
I mean, they're able for like a drug dealing gang of three guys. They're very efficient. They keep getting the people they want. Like they get pretty close. You know, they don't miss them. They maybe might have missed them once, but like in terms of actually confronting them, they are like pretty accurate.
Well, forgot to mention they already got captured once by Lee Majors because he posed as a cop, and then like arrested them, and, like locked them in like a hotel room.
And then they just get freed.
Yeah.
Which kind of funny that they got arrested and got the drop on them. They come to this Arizona town that probably was going to do something like this, kind of messed up and racist.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, I'm thinking of the time, man. It's mm-hmm. just like, you also come in and you're in these, like, I don't know, like, they're already looking for trouble, you know? Mm-hmm. So they're very calm about being pulled over by the cops. They're like, what, the cops are off? I was like, eh. You speed, not speed. They're very casual about that. I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
It's like, they probably have drugs in their car because they're drug dealers. But they're not, like, it's so weird that Lee Majors has a, like, a no-kill policy, but, well, one, you can't kill your bounty and not collect on it, I guess.
Yeah.
But he has no bounty on these guys. You gotta mess them up.
Yeah, he only loads his gun with blanks because he uses it more as, like, an intimidation tactic and not, like, a, like, weapon.
I feel like I've seen that in other things. So I think, is this where it's from, just having a blank gun? Just to scare people.
I'm sure it's probably been like other stuff. I can't think of anything off the top of my head, like something like that. But I'm sure it's something else that does that, or someone else that does that.
So later on, he does do that again. It's a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Just waving his gun. Second episode, at least, and mm-hmm. that's the guy with a real gun. Like, there's a guy with a real gun, and he's got the blank gun, and he's just like unafraid about that.
Well, his blank gun saves him in this episode because, like, the drug dealer guys, like, the boss, like, use his own gun and, like, take him out and then, like, make it look like he shot himself. And then he does, like, a, like, Lee Majors does, like, a fake, like, death fall. And then, like oh, yeah, we killed him. We're not going to confirm anything, but, like, he's dead.
So they thought they killed him for
yes.
at least, like, a week, right?
A while, yeah, a couple days at least, probably.
Okay, because yeah, I was wondering with the scene where at the cop, where Lee pretends to be the cop, and the driver, who I think was the one who fought him and shot him,
mm-hmm.
he just looks at him and he's just like, it doesn't click yet.
Well, it doesn't click at first, and then he like realizes like, oh, it's that dude we shot and killed. he's a cop now.
He's a zombie. He's back for revenge.
Yeah.
I don't know, I always feel like when you do attempted murder on the hero, it's kind of like a pass if the villains do something that get them killed, and then the hero doesn't like step in to stop that.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I feel like that is just like, oh, it's fair game. Especially when he's all about bounty hunting. Like, wait, you have no bounty? I can let you go. Just drops him in the ocean.
Well,
he's like, I have no bounty on them.
Then you're worthless to me.
yeah, something cool. Like, guess what, guys? You're the fall guys. You see what I mean? There
yeah.
are ways to craft it. I wonder if the new fall guy is going to do that.
I feel like so neither of us have seen the movie yet because they're like recording this before it comes out. I mean, it's out now if you're hearing this. But I feel like the movie's going to do the thing where it's like this whatever this adventure is. In the movie, is going to lead to him like being like, "Oh, I could be a bounty hunter. I should do this like more." It's gonna be like kind of like the prequel, like the origins of like him becoming a bounty hunter / stuntman.
I could see that where it's not exactly just picking up like right in year 5 of him bounty hunting as like
yeah,
like the way they mention this as a bounty hunting thing, moonlighting, it makes it seem like he's a fucking caterer. You know, like, oh, I have a gig. I have to cater this party. It's just,
yeah,
you're trying to hunt another human.
I mean, it basically is like you know how like actors work as like waiters or something. It's like yeah, he's a stuntman, but he's also working as like a bounty hunter. It just happens to be like he has this like equally crazy like side job.
So typical stunt people, their side gig is either like fitness trainer or like martial artist.
Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah,
it's something that kind of like got them into Hollywood, but this this one was weird. This one is like, oh, what was your talent? Just like being Lee Majors and being handsome.
I could take a punch. I could take a punch. I'll might be set on fire. I could crash a car.
But I just can't figure out how like the banking works. Just what brought you to the bounty hunting? Bad financial decision. Buying my love of horses. Just buying teaching me horses.
I have two horses, but I live in a shack.
Like
a shack, like way up in the mountains of Los Angeles.
Think about it. He drives that Jeep up that mountain. That's why he has to drive the Jeep, right?
It's his pickup truck. Yeah,
pickup truck. But then that's like probably 15 miles to the gallon.
In the '80s, yeah.
And then it's like, I guess gas was definitely cheap, but it's just like you're burning gas back and forth off that mountain to drive to the Hollywood. Like, he's in the Hollywood Hills driving down to be at, like, the 20th Century Fox lot. But anyway, I don't get into the micromanaging. Now it just sounds insane of just having, like, a gas guzzler and then just going to work and then you're like, what? You're going to get paid $20. The gas is 40.
I mean, his cousin offers to be his manager. He probably does need a manager. Like be like, why are you? Yeah, like your gas expenses are like through the roof, and you're like this shack is like.
Oh, they're actually like feeding his.
Yeah.
So it's like you've now inherited another horse.
Mm-hmm.
Jody was actually pretty good. You're right. Jody does like not a lot of shining in the first episode, but she gets better as the show goes on. Like, she has more screen time. She's actually stunting.
Yeah. It's really strange that like you would like sideline like one of your three stars to like not do anything in like your big like pilot episode.
Well, it's still like 1981 when this came out, so it was just like I think Cagney and Lacey was just starting, ending, so they just got the idea of like Action Woman. Wonder Woman just ended, I think.
Well, I think there was The Bionic Woman was out, I think, too. Because this was like Lee Majors' like big like 3 years before this, he was in $6 Million Man.
Yeah, yeah.
And then this is like his big follow up after that. And then
the Woman came out near the tail end of Bionic Man, but I
yes, and then ended,
like only had like one or two seasons.
But then like I think Lindsay Wagner like guest starred on like the Fall Guy at some point in like the first season. It's like a kind of inside joke or like there's a lot of people like either worked with like Lee Majors or like worked with like Glenn A. Larson who like created the show, and a lot of like his like regular people show up too.
That makes sense. I mean, it's like especially at the time, it's that like close knit who you know community. But yeah, I just looked up Bionic Woman. It was like it ended in 1979 or 78. They only had like 3 seasons. So it ended around the same time Bionic Man ended.
And then, like, I mean, Glenn Larson, like, he also, I mean, he created Fall Guy. He also created, like, Magna P.I., Knight Rider, Battlestar Galactica, Buck Rogers.
Holy crap.
One of our favorites of all time, Nightman. Manimal. Automan. Automan was like fake. It was like fake Tron. Like it was a police officer, but then he got like turned into like a holog. Like I think it was like. Oh no! There was a hologram that called Automan, and then he was in the real world. It was basically like if Tron came to the real world, but then he could turn into like other. He could turn into like vehicles and stuff. And so it was like this. It's like this police detective and like a hologram like digital being fought crime.
Jesus. All right, that alone we'll probably do another rewatch.
We might, yeah. If we want to do more TV shows, we might have to like watch that at some point too.
But not to drag on so much about the Fall Guy, just because if you sum up every plot beat, it's a short thing. But
we have mentioned like so like the drug dealer is get their comeuppance is Lee Majors uses the hook on the helicopter, which he says he's done before, and he hooks their car and like leaves them on the top of the Grand Canyon, I think, or like some sort of like desert like mountain.
don't think it's the Grand Canyon because it's surrounded by water.
Yeah. It's some sort of like desert like high plateau, which will they ever get down? Who knows? They're probably dead.
Like I said, Lee Majors, he didn't want to outright kill them, but he didn't have to save them. He
yeah.
Batman moved there.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that's his revenge. That's what I'm saying. It's a, you know, he didn't kill them, but he killed them in the end.
Yeah. I hope you guys can climb. Like, because that's like a sheer drop down.
It's just a fall.
And like, y'all wear like, you're not wearing any sort of like anything close to like a mountain climbing equipment. You're like suits. So it's like.
There's no cell phones, so
they're yeah.
stuck. Lee Majors mm-hmm. has to like remember where in this random desert he dropped them off after he lands this thing in California, outside of the county line.
Yeah, hopefully he radioed someone to like, hey, I left these three guys on like a plateau in like the desert.
Hopefully you can find them in time.
Yeah, find them before they die of thirst.
Or drugs.
And then we mentioned, but then episode finishes out with he does a car. He jumps a car onto watermelons, which doesn't seem like compared to like other stunts that have happened in this episode, like doesn't seem that crazy. But he's
very tame.
Yes, like it's like, you know, it's just like a kind of a smallest jump, and then he's just land on like watermelons and smash the ball. But he's doubling for Farrah Fawcett. So you can see Lee Majors in like a Farrah Fawcett, like kind of like wig and dress.
So during this time, Lee Majors and Farrah Fawcett were separated and divorcing like mm-hmm. next year. So that's the bittersweet thing about that part. It's like Farrah Fawcett's like, oh, I know you, and it's like,
oh yeah, the whole scene is like so weirdly like it's just like totally different energy from the rest of the episode. It's like this like really like, yeah, like you said, bittersweet. It's like,
I didn't know that.
Take care of yourself, man. Take care of yourself. You look good. Yeah. Okay, you look good. Yeah.
Yeah, but we're just passing through. It's like, holy shit! Like that's not just the script telling them. That's them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I kind of forgot Lee Majors and Farrah Fawcett were an item. They were a power couple in the 70s then.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, because I was looking on line, I was like, wait a minute. They're like, the way they act in that wasn't just like, okay. Like, they're not in the same scene together, you know? Like, it's not that couple. Like, they had a, okay, we're like, working through this divorce. Like, to, like, see it through. Like, whoa. I thought that was nice.
Mm-hmm.
Again, the rest of the season, the first season one, not the same. It's just more. It's more like gags and like a lot of talk, don't show. Because Lee Majors, I mean, not Lee, like Colt, he'll bring up other previous cases we haven't seen. Where he's like, "Oh, do you remember the heroin in the vase? Do you remember this? Do you remember the guy with the knife for like a foot? Blah, blah, blah. Like, wait, what? What's happening in like your life?"
Yeah, well, yeah. Thank God, there's like the like Lee Majors like intro where he like kind of explains the premise, because if that wasn't there, you would get dumped in like in media res, just like, and you have to like pick everything. I mean, you could probably pick everything up, but it'd be like way more like for an 80s, especially for like an 80s TV show. Like if it didn't have that intro, that would be like a really like people would be like lost, I think, compared to like other shows where like the pilot is like explicitly lays out all everything that happens. Or like introduces everything. It was like a lot of 80s pilots would be like, "Hey, I'm new in town," or like, "Hey, I'm a new character to this like police station. Explain everything to me. Like, explain all who all the characters are in this police station."
Yeah, I'm trying to think the show that had a similar premise like that of you are dropped into this and you get a reintroduction might be Brooklyn Nine-Nine. Where there are other previous things that have happened, but the first episode is introducing the new character, Holt. Mm-hmm. And then it's like him realizing that like he's way more stern than the rest of the group.
So, yeah, and then you get like Terry Crews explaining like, oh, let me introduce you to every single character on the show.
Right. So they kind of do that with the cousin, with Howie.
Yeah.
But then they stop. Like, he never talks to Big Jake. like in the first part, you know, like he doesn't get like an introduction to the potential like bounty. You know what I mean? Like it's mm-hmm. just sort of like things just happen. I don't think he's even there for the nightclub part, right? Like it's like a whole different arc is the nightclub scene where
Colt knows when like there's that waitress, and then the waitress kind of like takes him to a table and is like, "Hey, sit here. Wait for your cousin to do what his actual business." Like, stay here, dummy. Like
he doesn't. I get it. It's his first time, but still, it's just like I would have liked to see Lee explain, like, "All right, we have to do this." You know, blah blah blah. We'll look out.
But yeah, there's a lot of history and like backstory stuff that you. I don't know if they explain it like later in the show, but like for the first episode, Lee Major's been doing this for a long time. Like, him and Jody's partnership, and then like him and Big Jack's partnership and all that stuff. It's like you know what's going on. You know, it's like it's been going on for a while. Like,
you know, Lee Majors from $6 Million Man.
But Fall Guy, super fun show. Hopefully the movie is as fun. It seems like it's getting pretty good reviews, so I'm sure we'll check it out at some point.
I feel like if the movie fails, I think the smarter thing would have been a TV show or a limited series. Like a safer method, because the Fall Guy, even though it's like a landmark 80s show, it just never got like the love past like the 2000s. You want to talk about just like how hard it is to watch the show, or like how like
I think you can only buy the first season on like Amazon or like Vudu or like Apple TV or something like that. It's not, and then no other seasons are available. There was like DVDs of the first two seasons, but that's it. Like the last three seasons have never been released in physical media. And they're not just streaming somewhere where you can actually watch them on streaming. I think we both had like, well, I went on Daily Motion because like it's on Daily Motion. If you want to like search for the Fall Guy in there, there's like all the episodes or most of the episodes.
And then I found it some way.
Yes, another like legally dubious way, but that's like the only way to like really see like especially like the last three seasons are nowhere. Like, well, two, three, four, and five are not legally available to purchase, and then like one and two you could maybe buy on physical media, but yeah, very very difficult show to try to watch. Which it's so weird. There has to be some sort of like the rights must be like split between different companies or something, because it was an ABC show, but then 20th Century Fox produced it, but then Disney has control of both those entities now. So is it Disney, but then Universal is putting out the movie? So I mean, because it seems like it would, like if there was like a no like legal issues, this would probably be on like, you know, Paramount Plus or Amazon or like Hulu, or like it'd be on whatever company owned the rights to it, because you know, that seems like a very solid like catalog show to have. You know, like Miami Vice is like on like Peacock. You can just watch all of Miami Vice and Peacock, and like a lot of these other like kind of 80s shows are available like all over the place. But yeah, The Fall Guy is just nowhere to be found. Maybe if the movie is like a big success, maybe they'll finally like get like whoever owns it to be like, "Hey, we should put this out somewhere." We're getting like Blu-rays or something of it.
I hope they kind of revitalize that. Like, it's such a in terms of build up for the movie, there would have been a release of something. There would have been like Lee Majors would have came out and then done like some talk or something.
Well, he's got a cameo in the movie.
Not the same.
Yeah.
Like what, like to do the proper marketing. Like when they were doing the Brady Bunch movies, they got the original cast to do some marketing and appear mm-hmm. more on TV.
Yeah.
I don't see Lee Majors tweeting about like, "Hey, I'm going to be in The Fall Guys." You know, it does not make sense. So it's, and especially when this show is more for the prior generation, like, because we were too young for Fall Guy. Like, even if I was a kid watching this, which I think I've seen this as a kid, I didn't understand half the jokes or half of the context. So it's a very, like silly action things for adults who are now older. And I don't know. It just, like, it is, like, a weird misgap because this movie's meant for our generation. Mm-hmm. We didn't grow up on this. The comedy, though, and the action is meant for, like, our group. So I just want to know who the audience is for this new, like, their new market. If you want to get new people in it, I figure release the old one. Kind of reintroduce people back to the old one.
Yeah.
We had to seek this out.
And it's like every other kind of big 80s show has, like, CBS has, like, what? they had Hawaii Five-O, they had Magna P.I., they had MacGyver. I mean, they brought all those back. It's like new shows. And we had the one A-Team movie, and then nothing ever shows from that. So that's kind of like also like a kind of like a
that dropped the ball.
Yeah, like you think there'd be like some sort of like new A-Team thing, but because that's like probably one of the biggest 80s, like in this sort of like genre like era slash genre like action 80s kind of action adventure shows, like A-Team is probably like, you know, number one. But yeah, hopefully it's maybe like more easily available. But I mean, you can watch the first episode on Everything Action. We embedded it there, so if you want to watch the episode we watched, it's on there. And then you go to other areas of the internet to watch other episodes if you want. I think some are on YouTube, but like not like season one episodes. It's like a lot of like season like three I saw was up there, like someone just like for some reason just put like a lot of like season three Fall Guy up there.
That's weird.
Yeah, but yeah, I think they'll do it for this week's episode. I'm sure, like, if we see the Fall Guy, I'm sure check the site for the movie, we'll check out the site for a review at some point. And kicking off the summer movie season, so I'm sure we'll have like a lot more reviews and stuff to talk about as the summer goes on. And if
any big movies looking forward for?
I mean, probably like Furiosa. Hopefully that's awesome. Hopefully Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes is awesome. Deadpool Wolverine is probably my most anticipated one.
Hasn't been anything on the mid or end of the summer yet, so yeah, these summer blockbusters roll out.
Yeah, I'm trying to think what else is like coming out. There's like A Quiet Place Day One is coming out. Oh, Twisters.
Oh, I forgot about that.
I think we'll definitely have to talk about Twister when Twisters comes out. Borderlands, that could go either way.
Yeah.
Oh, the Crow remake.
I forgot that's a thing too.
Yep.
I
mm-hmm.
That was gonna come as a treat to DVD.
Alien Romulus. Hey. Yeah, seems like Bad Boys Ride or Die. Yeah, it's gonna be an interesting summer. Seems like there's gonna be like a lot of like either they're gonna be like huge hits or giant bombs. But yeah, keep an eye on the site for we'll definitely have like reviews of like a lot of the summer movies, and we'll probably like talk about either like something related to them or the actual movies themselves on the podcast. So stay tuned for that, and. Check out the site for reviews and our commentaries. We have a commentary for What did we just do? Friday 13th. The final chapter we just put up, so that you can watch that with us. And a new one on the way at the end of this month. I think we're kind of like leaning toward possibly Terminator Salvation, but maybe something else will jump up. But that's in the front right now. So if you want to watch that with us. Stay tuned. And so for Chris, I am Zach, and we will see you next week.
For more From Everything Action, head to www.everythingaction.com. You can also find us on Facebook at facebook.com/everything.action and follow us on X at EVAction. We're also on Instagram and Threads at everything.action. Find more episodes of the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your podcast app of choice, and be sure to rate and subscribe.